Hey, I'm Rick Uzi, Zcorum. I'm here with Marty Kuchel from Zcorum, a solutions architect with us. And today we're going to be talking about auto configuration servers, or known as an ACS for short. And so we have been involved in broadband for a long time, working with both DOCSIS providers as well as telcos. And you know, so we've seen ACS for a long time. And there have been, Marty, there have been a lot of reasons that people have wanted to have this, kind of starting out kind of early, but mm-hmm. why don't you give us kind of a high level of what an ACS is?
Yeah, what an ACS is basically a management server that controls or monitors and configures any type of TR69 compatible CPE device, such as a modem, DSL modem. There's a bunch of equipment out there now that is TR69 compatible, such as IoT devices and so forth. So this server basically has the ability to control and to push configurations down to them.
Mm-hmm. So where we started to see the need for this, again, being working with all kinds of broadband providers, we work with a lot of cable operators. So they had the opportunity, you know, as a cable operator to not need any kind of an ACS. They could install a cable modem and it would automatically get configurations that it needed and mm-hmm. if they needed to do firmware right. updates. But what's the situation, let's say, for an operator that had DSL out in the field?
Well, yeah, DSL was basically a black hole for the telco providers. There was really no way for them to access the device until it, once it went out in the field. Once it got deployed to the customer site, it was a black hole. The providers really didn't have any control over it. So if there was any type of configuration change or software upgrades, they had to send out a truck roll. Mm-hmm. And it was basically a lot of money being spent for these providers to send out truck rolls just for something simple as an upgrade or configuration change. Mm-hmm. So that's why this was developed. It went hand in hand with a standard called TR69. TR69 was developed in 2004, with ACS being the management platform for the protocol.
Mm-hmm. So again, some of the challenges of that. An operator might have that was doing DSL, just even getting the customer installed, because if I'm correct, they had to actually open the DSL modem, mm-hmm. take it out, put it on a bench or something, plug it in,
right.
configure it, put it all back in the box, and of course they could be making mistakes as they're trying to type in MAC addresses or whatever they're having to do there.
Absolutely.
They'd associate with a customer, right?
Yeah, that is correct. And so, whenever there was a work order that was put in for an installation for a DSL modem, the technician basically did exactly what you said. You know, they got a box, pulled it out, did the configurations, and they had to note it that it was for that specific customer. Mm-hmm. And if it was any type of mistake or something was done wrong, then the install just went bad.
Mm-hmm. So You've got the install, and then once you've installed it, you could send it to the customer at that point, or mm-hmm. go out and install it, and then, as you were saying, it's out there. So you can imagine an operator that's installing these devices, and then suddenly they've got 100 out in the field, they've got 500, they've got 1,000,
right?
And then let's say they've got a new firmware level,
right?
What do they do, right?
Yeah, what do they do? Do you send a truck out or a technician out to thousands of homes?
That's
not
no.
yeah. Yeah, that's not possible. So, in essence, what you have is you have the ACS now that has control mm-hmm. and has the ability to go in to each one of these modems or a group of modems and push or download the new firmware upgrade mm-hmm. or a new configuration file.
Yeah. Another challenge we would see on the technical support side is, let's say a customer had a modem out there and they by mistake pushed the little reset button
right,
on the top.
Yeah.
So they might have different settings in there for port forwarding or some other kinds of settings that they've had put in that modem, and then suddenly all that stuff's blown away. And I think one of the advantages you have with an ACS server is you can store some of those custom settings on the ACS server.
Absolutely. What it is, whenever a modem is being discovered or a CPE device, it doesn't matter which one it is, Whenever it's discovered by the ACS, there is a set of parameters that is usually associated with that model. So that whenever that model comes into the database, it's called a CWMP, and that model is recognized by the ACS saying, okay, I get these sets of parameters. So you have a baseline that is already put into the device itself, and then once it comes up online, then you can go in there and then you can add the customized parameters, such as SSIDs, passwords, and so forth. So, you know, what you want to do is that you want to get the base configurations into the unit while it's on site, when it comes up. So basically the technician doesn't have to do anything. Mm-hmm. You know, he just goes in there, makes sure that it's powered up right, it's cabled up right, and the ACS does the rest of the work.
Mm-hmm. So from a support perspective, again, an ACS can be of great value for the support team because, as you said, they can, if a customer calls and says, I can't remember my password, right, can you help me, they can do some of those things remotely if they've got an interface that allows them to do that.
Absolutely, and it's a real great tool for whenever you have like an application into a campus environment, colleges, MDUs, apartment complexes, so that whenever you have a high turnover of people going in and out, you know, leasing your apartment for a couple of months, you know, the modem or the device stays there, the customer leaves. So what you want to do is that you want to turn off the Wi-Fi, and you want to wipe out the SSID, you want to wipe out the password, mm-hmm. so that whenever the new customer comes in or the new tenant, they basically, you power everything back up, and it still has all its configurations except for the customized ones, mm-hmm. the SSID, passwords. So when it comes up, you just only go in there and you supply the new name, new password, SSID, and so forth. Mm-hmm. So it's a great tool for whenever you're churning customers in that type of an environment.
Mm-hmm. So what about diagnostics? So you've got some management capabilities.
Yes.
Can you pull some diagnostics information?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You can look at the uptime. You can look at how many bits and bytes have been, you know, going across the network on that device itself. You're able to turn it on, turn it off. You can run ping tests. You can run loopback tests. So there's a whole range of diagnostic tools, as long as it's recognized by that ACS, that can be performed remotely so that you can determine if I am being attacked, maybe by a denial of service attack. You can go in there, you can shut off that Wi-Fi.
So we've seen, I guess, the development then of just from starting from DSL and being able to, you know, to configure and maybe update some of these devices,
right,
now to some management capabilities, some diagnostics. Now we've got a lot less DSL out there, but we've got other kinds of, we've got fiber out there. We've got some, you know, what's the future for ACS as far as with these new technologies, GPON, Internet of Things?
Everything. With the advent of the Internet of Things, you know, there's going to have to be a way to control them, you know, and each one of them are going to have different capabilities, different types of parameters that you have to go in there and you have to control, mm-hmm. and you have to have access to. So that is going to be one of the biggest, I think, reasons that ACS is going to be really, really popular in the coming years, because of the fact that you got to control all this stuff. Mm-hmm. And the way that we are going right now with all the IoT, there's going to be tons of them in your home, and you have to have some way of controlling that. Mm-hmm. So we're looking at, you know, IoTs as being probably the next big thing for ACS.
Mm-hmm. Now, another challenge I know a lot of operators had, if they already had a whole bunch of devices in the field already that, and they didn't have an ACS.
Right.
And then they bring an ACS in, is those devices out there, unless they were programmed to call home to the right ACS server.
Right.
That was a challenge, even just getting those devices to now recognize that there was an ACS in the network.
That is correct. Yeah, what it is, any devices themselves, there's a URL that's mm-hmm. associated with the ACS. So it's pointing that device to an internet address, okay? And that's where the management server is sitting at. If you do have an existing network out there, there are some DHCP servers that have options that whenever you assign an IP address, mm-hmm. you can put that option in there also with that URL. So whenever you do bring up that ACS, all you have to do is just turn on or turn off and turn back on that CPE device, and it's going to get its IP address from the DHCP server along with that URL now. So there is now a way, mm-hmm. you know, it's not like, oh my God, what am I going to do?
Yeah.
I've got all these modems or all these devices out there, I can't reach them. With the advent of the ACS, now we're coming into that option with the DHCP servers that you can put that URL into that discovery.
Great, okay. I know in the past I had told people that it was maybe a good idea. And does that always work? Do you have to have DHCP?
You have to have DHCP, right.
Yeah, because one thing we've always suggested is if you don't have an ACS now but you were thinking about it, is go ahead and create a URL that you may not be using now, mm-hmm. like maybe acs.yourdomain.net.
Right.
And usually wherever you're buying your equipment from can go ahead and place that in the device. So then if those devices are in the field, even though you're not using it now, later, with a simple change to DNS, they can also then point
exactly
to that, and then put an ACS where it's supposed to be.
Yeah, I was working. This was a couple of years back at another company, and they were bringing in an ACS brand new. Mm-hmm. And what they were doing was that they were telling their customers to bring the modems back.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this was a DSL type of environment, so mm-hmm. each customer had to bring in their modem into a store.
Yeah.
They would give them that old modem and a new one would go out to them, because exactly what they were doing was they were burning in that configuration or URL for the ACS server into the new modems.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that was the easiest way they could do it at the time.
Yeah, I guess to have them come to you instead of you go to them.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so it is a good idea to prepare in advance if you mm-hmm. can. Again, either by making sure that you control the URL that's in that device, meaning at your domain name, you can make a DNS change, or the DHCP thing is very interesting as well.
Yes, so, it is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I guess moving forward, we're going to be seeing, even though it seemed like ACS maybe had a limited lifetime, mm-hmm. it's going to be something that a lot of operators are going to be using.
I think so. We're seeing more and more providers that are starting to use ACS more and more because of the fact that, it does fill that void of not having management or visibility into those devices.
Mm-hmm.
ACS gives you that visibility and the ability to go in there and make the changes as need be.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Thanks a lot, Marty.
Okay,
so
thank you.
There you go. So that's what an ACS is. If you like this video, please go ahead and like it. You can always subscribe to our videos and just click the notification button or the notification bell, and you'll get notified anytime we're live. Thanks a lot for watching on this Tech Tuesday. Next week, I'm going to start talking about, I think I'm going to do a two-week series on cellular, and we're going to start with 1G to 4G, which some of us have experienced all of that, you and I. Some people maybe only 3G or 4G is why you've been around, but we're going to be talking about 1G to 4G, and then the week after that, I'm going to be talking about 5G, the next thing in cellular. We'll see you then.